please visit us. Prepare us to be perfected, to be sanctified, to be prepared, whether it's this season or some other day and hour or season. We know this season, the Feast of Trumpets, Rosh Hashanah, Hashanah, the beginning of a new year, and the time of also examining ourselves, repenting unto the Day of Atonement, the days of awe, leading to the day of Yom Kippur. Yom, light, and day, Kippur, Atonement, redemption. We know, Lord, your redemption is nigh unto those who look to you. Not only the redemption of our spirit and soul, but of the body also. Sanctification and glorification for all of your people that are calling upon your name and trusting in thee, Abba, 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 Father. Abba YahOshahvah, YahOshahvah YahOshahvah, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come to earth. Thy will be done, even as it is in the third heaven. Thy will be done upon the earth, even as it is in the third heaven. Perfect will. Your government, your sovereign will. Your glory, your harmony, your peace, your holy shalom. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. In earth, on earth, throughout all the earth, in every nation. We thank you for your provision, Jehovah Yireh. We thank you for your deliverance from this present evil world. And you have promised to deliver us from the wrath to come. You have promised to deliver your bride and your people from your judgments and your wrath that this world fully deserves,
yes,
and all its kingdoms. Your wrath will be upon the wicked and the rebellious and your enemies.
Yes, Lord.
And the pedophiles and the rapists and the Jezebels and the Ahabs and the pretenders.
Yes, Lord.
The criminals, the rioters, the violent, the perverse, and the lovers of the world. But, O Lord, we that you have called out, the Ecclesia, your church, your bride, your people, we are in the world, but not of the world.
Yes, Lord.
We are not to be found of the world, but there are many that are in the world and of the world,
mm-hmm,
and very much tied and attached to the world.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Lord.
Call them out, Lord. Use us to call them out. We will warn them. You have called us, not only called us out of Babylon and out of the world, you have called us to be witnesses and warriors of prayer.
Amen.
Worshippers.
Yes, Lord.
Worshippers and warriors of prayer.
Yes, yes, Lord.
And watchmen. Warriors in prayer and watchmen that warn. That's part of our calling.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Lord.
Especially those that you have called in the ministry of Elijah to prepare the way,
mm-hmm,
before the judgments fall.
Mm-hmm.
And when the judgments fall, it will be decimation.
Mm-hmm.
Even as it would be the holy fire and decimation at the end of the millennium.
Mm-hmm.
O Lord, Abba Father, you are and you know how to do your house cleaning.
Mm.
In heaven, first heaven, the second heaven, and on earth. You are the supreme house cleaner.
Amen.
And purger.
Yes, Lord.
And refiner.
Yes, Lord.
And a consuming fire. Yahweh, YahOshahvah, YahOshahvah is an eternal flame of holy fire and love. Grace is given to the humble and the repentant. But God, the Father, God resists the proud and the rebellious. And no one can fake their way through that.
Mm.
You only accept reality. You only accept what's real. Because thou knowest,
yes,
O Lord, all the pretenders, the hypocrites, and the people who don't walk the talk.
Yes,
walk the way. Your Son is the way, the truth, and the life, the way to reconciliation, the eternal life of God by the Holy Spirit, and the truth of the Word, the living Word, the quickened Word, not the dead Word, not the dead letter, not the self-righteous Pharisee Word, not the Talmud, not the Kabbalah, not the Koran, the Holy Word of God from Genesis to Revelation.
Amen. Yes, Lord.
Sealed by the Holy Spirit. The world's best seller and often the least read. The Bible and the New Testament. Billions have been printed in many languages.
Amen.
New Testament and Bible. Billions!
Yes, Lord.
And billions of tracts, gospel tracts. But the Bible is mostly one of the least read books. Though, Lord, thou knowest, it's been distributed throughout all the earth.
Mm.
And you said, nobody else could say this, you said clearly when you were upon the earth, YahOshahvah, heaven and earth will pass away. And it will at the end of the millennium. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my word, the words that I have spoken, will not pass away, said the Lord. The Lord, Yeshua, YahOshahvah, HaMashiach. YahOshahvah, Yeshua, YahOshahvah,
yes, Lord,
the Messiah. Though heaven and earth pass away, your words are still with us throughout all the earth, 2,000 years later. Everything that you have ever spoken will come to pass. And Lord, that includes the last hours of Revelation and the prophecies about the beast system and the beast and the false prophet and the Antichrist. Help me today, before we play the shofar now, help me and anoint me. Help me, Lord,
yes,
to declare and show forth what you have been revealing, the very clear evidence that all the religious Jews, especially the Orthodox and the ultra-Orthodox and the Shabbat, worldwide, but especially in Israel, worldwide, they are all praying earnestly and believing that their Jewish Messiah is about to appear on the scene. And some rabbis say, we've already been consulted with him. We talked with him face to face. We've been talking with him. Peace and security. A man of peace, a negotiator, the deal of the century. Awaken, O slumbering church. Awaken, open your eyes and your ears, and see and understand what is really happening today, now. For the church and the restrainer will be taken out of the way. Be ready. Be ready. Be a wise virgin. You'd better have oil and a flame burning in the light, even in the night. And gross darkness covereth all the earth and the nations. Gross darkness. And we can call it ecumenical. Men. Ecumenical unity and delusion. Covering the whole earth, all the nations. Only the five wise virgins. They have a lamp burning with the light of love for their husband, who alone can open the door to come up. Yeshuah! Oh, we have no hope in this world but you. And you are a living hope. You are the living word, you are the quickened word, you are the eternal word made flesh, Emmanuel. You are the only one who really can be called Emmanuel. No one should be called Jesus or Jesus or any of those names. You are Emmanuel. And you are the one that will call us up in your time, not ours. But we hope it's very soon, Lord. We know it's very soon. We hope it's even this year. Many are hoping and longing, though they be few. Still, those of the few, many or nearly all of them, are hoping and longing. Lord, let it be this year. May it be this year. We're called up and called out of here. Then call whoever you will and do whatever you will with the two witnesses and 144,000 of 12 tribes. That's all your domain. We're your bride. We're your people. We want to be out of this filthy, stinking, perverse, and rebellious, untoward generation and world.
Yes, Lord.
But we are ready to stay as long as you require, Lord.
Amen.
Because you said, be my witnesses. Be my witnesses. And occupy until I come.
Amen.
We're determined to do that, Lord. I'm determined to do it. I know I'm weak, but it's your grace and your strength.
Amen.
We want to occupy. We want to be your witnesses in the earth. And watchmen. And warriors. You haven't called us to be wimps, but warriors. In the name of the Lord Yeshua, in the name of the Lord Yeshua, I will play the shofar and some worship music. We'll have a worship time, and then I have something very important to share outside this room. People need to know all the evidence and information God, just in the last 24 hours, just kept pouring it out to me and showing me the video clips and everything else that so clearly indicate the Jewish Messiah is about to be revealed. Emerge. It's already been all planned out 10, 20 years ago and longer. It's at least two decades in the works. And it's coming to its fruition. It's coming to its climax. That all these earnest prayers by Jews, Orthodox Jews, they want their Jewish king, Messiah, and deliverer, they want him now. And they say he's already in the earth. We know who the true Messiah is. and your false Messiah is going to answer to him.
Amen.
And all who follow me. Ever there was a time to seek the Lord, Yehovah, the Lord God of Israel, it's now.
Yes.
If ever there was a time to repent, it's now.
Yes.
More power, more of you.
prepare a way for thy people, O Lord. You are the way. You are the flame of truth and the flame of love.
More power, more of you in my life. More power, more of you in my life.
Yes, Lord. Be exalted in all the earth, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Even in your name and your identity, in your holiness and glory. YahOshahvah. 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 YahOshahvah.
Refresh us. Never die.
by the power of your blood and spirit and word, Lord.
Benjamin Warshawski, one of the great young cantors in the world, but he's also the most phenomenal for the shofar. You're about to hear an amazing shofar call. Live only at Ezra Habodimau's Talented Jewish Congregation in Skokie, Illinois, but now available to the whole world via video. Kia!
Kia!
Shvarim Trua!
Trua!
Kia. Shvarim Trua.
Trua.
Kia.
Yahua.
Shvarim Trua.
Trua.
Kia. Kia. Shvarim. Kia. Kia. Shvarim. Kia.
Yahua.
Kia. Shvarim. Kia. Kia. Trua. Kia. Kia. Trua. Kia. Kia.
Someday soon, that trumpet is going to sound from the heavenly place,
amen.
From the high heaven.
First, the Father will turn to the Son at the precise time. He knows everything. Nothing escapes his attention. And he will say, "My Son, it is time. Take your bride home." That's
amen.
In essence what he will say to the Son. And Jesus will arise
amen.
As a sovereign king. He longs for his bride more than we long for him.
Yes,
he longs to be with his bride, for those he died for.
Yes, Jesus.
He's awaiting the Father's order. The Father knows the exact time. And when he arises, all he has to do is say, let us go. And there will be the shout of an archangel,
yes,
and the trump of God. And it will be a massive, awesome blast. Jesus himself may blow the shofar. Yes. But there will be also the trump and the shout of the archangel. And first, all the dead in Christ will rise. No, that's going to be some supernatural event where those that they're already in heaven as a spirit and a body, they take on a glorified body, exactly like Christ. In the same sense that it is an eternal body, it is not subject to death, disease, or sin.
Amen.
Only the curses of sin.
Yes, Lord.
Think of having a body, a perfected spirit and soul, and a body that never gets tired or weary,
mm-hmm.
is subject to no virus, bacteria, or other disease,
mm-hmm.
and is eternal.
Yeah.
Will never grow old.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. A body that will have better than the prime of youth.
Mm-hmm.
Lord. Called glorification. And Lord, this is the Feast of Trumpets. It's started many hours ago, a few hours ago, and it is through this weekend. We want to honor the holy feast of Yom Teruah and the trumpet call. It's a call to repentance. It's a call to be ready for the day of judgment, the day of atonement. Yom Kippur, clearly from the scriptures, is not only about the day of redemption and atonement, it's a time of judgment, where everyone stands before the Bema Seat. This is not the Great White Throne. That's at the end of the millennium. But the Bema Seat of Christ, the judgment seat of Christ, once we're caught up, then it will be clear who gets what reward, who did what, and who didn't do what. And there are many, just as Paul made clear, there are many different degrees of honor and authority that is given. And it will all be made clear either before or probably after the marriage supper. You'll manifest all that, the hierarchy of rewards. There are many degrees of punishment in Hades, in hell. Many different degrees of punishment. And there are also many degrees of honor and blessing and reward in the third heaven, in your eternal kingdom. And we're all in agreement for your kingdom to come upon the earth, and Satan to be cast out, and all those that stand with him will be cast out. Then you will rule and reign for 1,000 years, and there will be one final test and sifting. It's beyond our understanding. But the flesh and the carnal mind of Adam's race often betrays and becomes an enemy of Christ the Creator and mediator between man and God, the Father. One great final purge. And thank you, Lord, that you're purging and preparing the people now. Help me, Lord, what I have to share now is burden. I don't pretend to have all the answers, but I have a lot of evidence.
God has been showing me. And it's for you out there that are not part of this meeting, for the people that I'm trying to reach through this video. I'm going to leave up on my Facebook. You can find my Facebook. It's very easy to find my Facebook. All the evidence in the last 24 hours that God showed me, that it looks almost inevitable to conclude that yes, the Jewish Messiah is getting ready to be take front stage. He is emerging as a mastermind of peace, a man of peace, a man of the Torah, a man of the Talmud, a man of Shabbat, a man that all the Orthodox Jews will hail as their Messiah, and many Reformed, and even many secular Jews. And then when he stops the war from destroying the earth and becoming nuclear, after the peace process is broken, the Abraham Accords, masterminded by the right-hand man of Donald Trump, a billionaire whose office that was purchased at the highest price ever paid for any office building, not only in New York, worldwide, the highest price paid for a 52-53 floor 1950s old office building. Almost $2 billion, $1.8 billion. And his, the Kushner building, which since has been auctioned off, but for years, for 4, 5, 10 years, the Kushner building at 666 Fifth Avenue in New York City, directly across from the Rockefeller Center, and just a few blocks down the way from Trump Tower, the Kushner building. And the peace process. Now I would urge everyone that is in the sound of my voice, look up all the evidence I have. I don't have time to go through it all now. It's right there at the top of my Facebook. Okay? I will leave a link with the YouTube. I'll make it very clear. These evidences are dots you must connect. Do your own research. Just don't take my word for it. These are things that have been revealed to me very clearly only in the last 24 hours. And I can't share all of them. I'll share with you what I have here, a few notes. Jared Kushner is clearly the prime candidate for the Jewish Messiah. Among all the Orthodox, all the Jews that are looking for a Messiah king, a man of peace, a great ruler who will establish Israel as a sovereign nation, secure and at peace, and rebuild the temple. Working in coordination with Donald Trump, Jared Kushner. Donald Trump he's Scottish, he's Presbyterian, but he's really now more Kabbalah and Jesuit than Presbyterian. His son-in-law and his daughter are both known to be Orthodox Jews, Shabbat. The Shabbat movement in Judaism among world Jewry is a large Orthodox Jewish movement whose primary goal is to bring in the Jewish Messiah. Now tell me, who is the right-hand man, most trusted advisor to Donald Trump?
Jared.
Who is the one that Donald Trump pointed in the audience and said, we're going to have the greatest peace deal of the century, and if anybody can do it, you can. Pointing to Jared Kushner. 666
6th Fifth Avenue. Purchased at a price no one else, that people just thought, this is from outer space. He's paying $1.8 billion for a medium-sized office building. It was like a gigantic, it was a huge purchase. It almost, by the way, it almost bankrupted the Kushners. So there's more to that. But for, I don't know how many years, I think 5 or 10 years, it was their headquarters, the entire Kushner Empire. Now, I'm going to have put on this video that we're putting together for our Shabbat sharing, several video clips. They're all on my Facebook, but I want to put it on the video as well, that are on the theme of how did Jared Kushner rise to a place of such great power. He's just a young man. He's in his 30s. It's fascinating what I found, what God led me and showed me on YouTube, news clips, interviews, documenting and showing how did Jared Kushner rise to such a place of prominent power. Another thing I need to mention.
Trump, throughout his career, has always relied on a very small circle of family and a couple of close associates. And in Jared Kushner, he has both. He has a family member as a son-in-law, and also Jared Kushner is a trusted advisor.
The effort will be led by Assistant to the President and Senior Advisor Jared Kushner.
President Trump has given Jared Kushner an extraordinary portfolio of responsibility. That includes bringing peace to the Middle East, reinventing the United States government, and many other issues. So it is a large, large task. From Kushner's perspective, he has 10 years in the business world. He ran a newspaper, The Observer, in New York. He ran a real estate empire, but that's basically it. Whether that prepared him for what he's taking on today is a big question.
Jared was thrust in the spotlight at a pretty young age. His dad went to prison when he was in his mid-young 20s. And Jared had to take over the company. He was chief executive when he was 25 and still in graduate school. And one of the first buildings he bought is this building, 666 Fifth Avenue. At the time when Jared and his company bought it, it was the most expensive purchase ever made in America of an American office building. And the market collapsed almost immediately afterwards.
What's going on in the stock market, and I know that the two of you know this, is a sideshow to a housing and debt problem in this country, whether we're down...
So Kushner had to renegotiate the debt that he owed, which meant people who held that debt would be paid less. There were a lot of very tense negotiations, and long story short, Kushner was able to renegotiate that debt.
And Richard Mack, according to other people who were in those negotiations, was one of the most resistant people to that idea. He was one of a number of different investors and lenders in the 666 Fifth Avenue property. He was upset that Jared had promised that he would make these payments, that the banks would be paid back at a certain rate, and unhappy that Jared came back saying, now I'm only going to pay you this, or a lower amount or a lesser amount, and some of that debt would be sort of set aside. Jared at the time owned a newspaper, the New York Observer.
He went to the editor of the Observer that he'd hired, a woman named Elizabeth Spears, and told her that there was a person named Richard Mack and that there was a negative story about him.
You know, we were having a meeting and he said, there's a story I think we should do and it's really important to me. And he gave me this tip that if it had checked out, it really would have been an Observer story. And then the reporter came back to me and said, you know, it's just not true. There's nothing there. You know, we'd meet weekly and he'd be like, so, you know, is there any progress in that story? And I would go, you know, Jared, there's just everyone we talk to tells us it's not true.
Some years later, Kushner was asked at a conference, how do you deal with conflicts of interest? He basically said they're inevitable, that if you don't want conflicts, go to your apartment and lock the door.
If you don't want conflicts, just go in your apartment and stay there and lock the door. And don't go to work, don't do anything.
An example of the way that Jared's two type of businesses interacted. He would occasionally use the Observer as a sort of a weapon against his enemies or rivals in real estate. And I think it raised questions among people in New York real estate about what kind of character Jared had.
The photographic image you may have, or the video image you may have of him, because of the way he looks with his boyish appearance, doesn't tell you the whole story. In fact, he is a sort of harder-edged version of what you see out there and more like Trump in the way he deals with folks.
Jared is such a hidden genius that no one understands.
I have not sought the spotlight.
I can't say enough good things about Jared and Ivanka. Ivanka's been just a great friend, and they do a lot of things behind the scenes that I wish more people knew about. I mean, to redo the NAFTA deal the way he did.
While he might have had difficulty getting in the door when it comes to getting Canada to the table, it's Jared who's credited with saving the nearly 2.5-decades-old free trade agreement between the U.S., Mexico, and Canada. That's because he knew Mexico's foreign minister from his days on Wall Street, and he formed close relationships with Canada's trade delegates, which helped when talks nearly broke down. Whether or not that's a mark of genius or simply negotiations 101, well, that depends on who you ask.
What I've done working with him on the Middle East peace plan, it is so unbelievably well done.
He has been working very hard on that, but his peace plan is indeed very hidden. We're told that it's detailed, but we don't know what the detail is. We're told that there are things both sides will like and both sides will not like. But in fact, in public, Mr. Kushner and the Trump administration have pretty much sided with one party, Israel, and alienated the other, the Palestinians, who are not even talking to him. So we'll see soon how Jared Kushner applies his genius to that situation, because the president has said the peace plan will be announced in the next 2 to 4 months.
They do a lot of things behind the scenes that I wish more people knew about, because we're a better country because they're in this administration.
A recent interview on Israeli radio again featured prominent rabbis explaining that the Messiah is just about to reveal himself. Rabbi Yaakov Zisholtz on Sunday told religious broadcaster Radio 2000 that Rabbi Chaim Kanievsky recently told him that he, Kanievsky, is already in direct contact with the Messiah. To understand why religious Jews are taking this seriously, it's important to know that Rabbi Chaim Kanievsky is considered one of the 2 or 3 top rabbis of the ultra-Orthodox Jewish community in Israel. And Rabbi Zisholtz says that Kanievsky and others of the mystical concealed rabbis have now tasked him with informing the public of the Messiah's imminent arrival. Rabbi Zisholtz began his explosive 3-hour interview with a warning. The process of redemption is about to start happening very quickly and at a fast pace. It is important that people remain calm and steady to act properly in the right time. There is a potential Messiah in every generation, and there are righteous men who know precisely who it is. This is, of course, true in this generation. Getting the word out now that the Messiah is closer than ever is a matter of life and death. Haven't you heard of Gog and Magog? That is what is going to happen very soon. Right now, the situation is explosive more than you can possibly imagine. Everyone needs to know whether they are on the inside or if they are going to be left out. He went on to reiterate a number of signs of which prominent rabbis have taken note and that they firmly believe to be evidence of the coming of Messiah. Rabbi Dov Kook, as everyone knows, is a very righteous man. He is one of the greatest men of our generation. And, 10 years ago, when Israel was suffering from a horrible drought, someone asked Rabbi Kook when the Sea of Galilee will again be full, recounted Rabbi Zisholtz. Rabbi Kook responded that when the Messiah arrives, the Sea of Galilee will be full. In a few weeks, the Sea of Galilee will be full for the first time since Rabbi Kook made this statement. The rabbi also pointed to Israel's inability to elect a government, which he said will not change in the upcoming third election scheduled to take place on March 2nd. Another righteous rabbi said that according to the current situation in heaven, there will not be Israeli elections, rather, there will be a war, cautioned Zisholtz. If the elections do take place, it's pointless since it will end like the other elections. No government will come out of it. No one will take the government away from Netanyahu. Decades ago, Rabbi Yitzhak Kadiuri, one of modern Israel's most revered sages, as well as the Lubavitch Rebbe, Rabbi Menachem Schneerson, both predicted that Benjamin Netanyahu would be the state of Israel's last prime minister prior to the Messianic Age. A great many, if not most of the ultra-Orthodox Jews in Israel continue to believe that to be true.
Mr. Netanyahu, I put a high value. My value is not the same.
Shalom Aleichem, everybody. I'm making this video today based off an article I just read where Rabbi Zisholtz, a top rabbi in Israel, has said that that there have been multiple top rabbis who are in communication with the Mashiach himself, and that things are going to start to develop very, very quickly, and that they want to alert and to inform everyone and update them on what's really going on right now. That the Mashiach himself is here. He is just waiting for the people to really be able to merit his coming. And he doesn't have enough power yet because, as we know, the king gets power from the nation. The Mashiach is connected to every single one of us. And when we do our job, we give life to the Mashiach. We give him more abilities. We connect him more to Hashem. And he connects us to Hashem. And then we can the redemption can be revealed. And this article is very, very powerful. I'm going to put it in the description. But it's talking about how multiple sources are speaking about how the Mashiach is here, and that things are going to, when things start to reveal, it's going to happen very quickly, and it's going to be overwhelming. So they're starting, this has been kept a secret for many years, but now they've been authorized to release this information. Everyone should know that the Mashiach is about to come, and that everyone should be sharing this video and the article that I put. I do not know all the details. I am, like you guys, I have read this article multiple times, and I'm giving my take on what I understood from it. So if you have more information about this, I suggest you comment below. But what I saw was they brought multiple rabbis. Rav Kook said that when the Kinneret fills up, that is a sign that the Mashiach is here. What have we seen? We've seen record amounts of rain this year. The Kinneret is almost completely full. We haven't seen this in so long. This is a great indication that Mashiach is here. And we are seeing crazy things unfold. Also, Rabbi David Abu Atzera has stated that the Baba Sali came to him in a dream and said, the Mashiach is offended that you didn't stand when he greeted you. So now he stands whenever he meets people. That the Baba Sali confirmed to him that he met the Mashiach. And he's here in Israel. Also, Rav Chaim Kanievsky would previously state that the Mashiach is coming through the door. Then he said the Mashiach's here. And now he said to his donors, every year he sends out donors to collect from America for the yeshivas. He said, do not leave. The Mashiach is too close. You have to stay here in Israel. We are seeing multiple signs that the Mashiach is coming. And that they're saying that when things start to gain momentum, things are going to happen very quickly. And things are that we've never seen before. That I'm not going to go too much into detail, but revelations are going to be revealed, and that the great leaders have authorized this information to be released to get people ready, because they don't want it to be completely a shock. So now they're starting to release the information on this. So Bezrat Hashem, it will be soon. and what we have to do. Because it doesn't mean that things are guaranteed. Even though we're getting all these signs that the Mashiach's here, we have to do even more, because always right before redemption, there's tests, there's challenges. Right before the light, there's always the darkest dark before the light. So we have to bring light to this situation. We have to do a little bit more. We have to encourage others in this situation to do more mitzvot, and that will speed up the process of Mashiach. It will gain momentum. And you know, we're seeing now with the elections, we don't know what's going on here with the elections in Israel, but some of the great leaders have said there will not be a government that will be formed from these elections. There will keep being re-elections, and then they will pass the torch to Mashiach. So Bezrat Hashem, the Mashiach will come tonight, today. If you know more about this article, please comment. I'm just sharing it over, giving it over to the world, Bezrat Hashem. So please share this video or share the article. Get the topic about Mashiach rolling, because we need momentum to bring Mashiach, Bezrat Hashem. We have to love each other. It's all about loving your neighbor as yourself and being nullified, connected to Hashem. Put down your own interests. Put aside your own needs for Hashem's needs. Become one with Him and find the true light in this world. Bezrat Hashem.
Go to the White House now, where President Trump will hold a ceremony today to sign a new peace deal normalizing relations between Israel and two Arab states, Bahrain and the United Arab Emirates. The president's senior advisor and son-in-law, Jared Kushner, played a key role brokering this agreement. He joins us now from the North Lawn of the White House. Good morning, Jared. Thanks for joining us this morning.
Thank you, George.
This agreement has the potential to be a truly transformational event in the Middle East. Even experts who've been critical of President Trump in the past, like Tom Friedman, call it a major breakthrough. So can you explain, what does it mean for U.S. national security? Why is it happening now?
Yes, thank you, George. Great to be with you. So this is the first peace agreement that happened in the Middle East in the last 26 years. This is between Israel and the United Arab Emirates. Then just last week, President Trump announced the second peace agreement that he was able to broker in 29 days. So we have two peace agreements being signed today at the White House between Israel and Arab countries. This really signals the end, we believe, of the Arab-Israeli conflict. There's still a lot more work to do, but for 70 years in the region, you've had the Arab countries not wanting to interact with Israel in a substantive way. This has led to a lot of people using hatred to do extremism, which has led to terrorism all throughout. And America over the last 20 years has been very, very distracted with the Middle East. We've had hundreds of thousands of troops that have been through the Middle East. We've obviously had a lot of terror, that we've had threats coming to America. So bringing peace to that region allows us to focus more here domestically and create less risk to America, and obviously bring our troops home, which is something that President Trump's been doing.
It has not ended the conflict between the Israel and the Palestinians. The Palestinians calling this a betrayal. Are there hopes for a state now dead?
No, look, I think that there's a lot of posture, right? In deals, everyone's at no until they're at yes. And I think what you're seeing is tremendous movement. They were caught by surprise by this. But what you're seeing is that the Arab countries want to focus on their citizens, and they want them to have better lives. And they're tired of waiting for the Palestinians to not be practical and make a deal. President Trump is a deal maker. A lot of the same people who have been critical of him said that if he was elected president, he would create wars. But today at the White House, you're going to see that he's making peace, and not just historic peace. He's making two of them at one time. And so the Palestinians have an offer on the table. At some point, when they decide that they want to live better lives, I believe that they'll engage. But, you know, we can't want peace for them and for their people more than they want it for themselves.
One concern in Israel and across the region is a proposed U.S. sale of F-35 fighter jets to the UAE. And there's a concern that this could spark a new arms race in the Middle East.
Well, actually, making peace will hopefully create less need for arms in the Middle East, because you'll have more focus on business and technology exchange and health exchange. What you have, obviously, is President Trump has reoriented our foreign policy in the Middle East. When he got into office, ISIS had a caliphate the size of Ohio. That's now been eliminated. Iran was flush with cash thanks to the terrible deal that was made by the previous administration. They were funding terrorists throughout the region who were causing instability all over the place. President Trump got out of that deal and rolled that back. What we've done is we've rebuilt the alliances and strengthened the partnerships with our traditional partners in the region. President Trump has brought everyone closer, and now he's pushing back. What he's doing is creating a new strategic framework that needs less American intervention, less American troops, less American treasure in that region, and hopefully creates more peacefulness, that there's less threats of terror to America.
One final question. You're also playing a key role in the COVID response, and we just saw that piece about Michael Caputo there at the Department of Health and Human Human Services saying he's worried about sedition by the scientists at the CDC, a resistance unit inside the CDC. Do you agree with that? And why is someone who had those views have a job of responsibility like that at HHS?
So obviously he works for the secretary there, Secretary Azar, who's done a very good job throughout this crisis. Look, I think that this is an unprecedented pandemic. There's a lot of tensions that have been very high with a lot of people. We've been making a lot of the right decisions. But again, President Trump has been focused on how do you make sure you get all the supplies to everyone who needs the supplies. That's been the role of the federal government. We're focused on Operation Warp Speed, which obviously we have three candidates in phase three trial for vaccine. The fastest vaccine ever to a phase three trial was 13 months. We've now done it in 4 months and then 4 months in one week. So we're moving forward on everything. We have a lot of people who have different opinions on different things, but that's part of what makes this, I think, a successful administration. And I will just say again, you know, President Trump doesn't do things in the Washington way. He does them in his own way, but he's created results. And that's what we're here today at the White House celebrating, which is, again, the first and second peace deal in the last 26 years in the Middle East, which obviously is a tremendous, tremendous breakthrough for the world.
Jared Kushner, thanks very much for your time this morning.
Thank you, George. Great to be with you.
666 Fifth Avenue. A prime piece of New York City's skyline, just six blocks from Central Park. Jared Kushner decided to make it his trophy in 2007.
This was the deal that put Jared on the map. I think every dynasty wants to own a piece of Manhattan.
To get the seller's attention, Kushner offered a big price, $1.8 billion, a record at the time. And the 26-year-old CEO of Kushner Companies borrowed aggressively to get the deal done.
They paid a peak price. Prices for real estate were especially inflated at the time.
Those prices tanked shortly after the purchase as the financial crisis set in. The entire deal was a miscalculation.
They'd absolutely paid too much at the time. He bought at the very top of the market. So then the market turned. You're not going to get the rent appreciation that you were probably projecting in 07.
To raise cash, the Kushners sold off some of the building's retail space and later had to bring in a partner. 10 years later, the building is struggling to cover its debt payments. This analysis by a firm that tracks bank lending shows the building's revenue has declined since the purchase.
It's old office space, right? It was built long ago. It's not exactly what new tenants want.
Earlier this month, a potential savior emerged. Chinese insurer Angbang considered an investment that could have helped the Kushners rescue Jared's ill-timed investment. But the deal fell apart.
Now they're left with a massive hole to fill. They're trying to redevelop the buildings as luxury condos at a time when luxury condos are having a lot of trouble. If it goes well for him, he's dodged a bullet. If it doesn't, he might lose a building and it might reflect badly on the family.
After the deal with the Chinese company fell through, the Kushners told us that they were talking to other bidders, but they wouldn't say who. And analysts aren't counting the Kushners out.
There's a lot of money that wants into New York and that will pay prices that some people will view as wow, that's unreal.
Jared Kushner sold his stake in the building to avoid the obvious conflict of interest. The family, after all, might have to take foreign money to make the deal profitable. But Kushner's proximity to power might also help attract that money.
You have someone connected to the president, right? That could bring in lenders, that could bring in a foreign partner that might be interested in getting an audience with Trump.
This is a very interesting piece of evidence. Call it a dot, if you will. Connect these dots. Jared Kushner is on record that his favorite fiction book and story, his favorite work of fiction, very famous, book written, a century or more ago. It is a story of revenge and dealing with your enemies. The name of the book is, listen to this, Alexander Dumas was the author, a very famous author. They made movies, I think at least three movies out of Hollywood, on this fictional book called The Count of Monte Cristo. That means the mountain of the anointed one. Now, the mountain of Messiah, Christ. His favorite book, and a lot of people don't know this, of course, but it's on record, is called The Count of Monte Cristo. the mountain of Christ, the mountain of the anointed one, the Messiah. Now, there's a lot of things. I'm not going to go over it all right now. I'm going to ask people to do their own research. It's all there on Facebook. I've listed it all. But there's such a thing as what the Jewish rabbis and the sages call gematria, it's called. They take a name in English, it's on the computer, it's a computerized calculation of what a particular name implies in the Hebrew, in the English, and what they call simple gematria. You can do your own research. I listed all these, the meanings that come up on the name Jared Corey Kushner. I'll go through a few of the things that come up in Hebrew and in English and in the numeric calculations of the meanings implied in that name. It's done through a computer. I have some here, and I'll read some also from Donald John Trump. Jared Corey Kushner gets these results. Lord of the Serpent. Georgia Guidestone. That comes up under his name. Antichrist Army, AVI. Judgment Day for America. Satanic NWO ended. New World Order. Satanic NWO ended. MIZ, not a Christian. This number, 666. There it is. You can look this up. Don't take my word for it. I give the link to the computerized calculations for the geometric meaning intrinsic or hidden in the name itself, the full name of the person. A tyrant is an understatement. That comes up. Satan, this is all from the website here. This is done by way of numerics, geometric numerics, and the meaning implied within the name. Satan thinks killing someone using black magic is honorable. Spirits of the world. By the way, the number here that comes up, there's three different numbers, but the one that this is referring to at this time is 1661. The other coordinates are 1200 and 200. So there's three different numeric values that come up by way of geometric calculations. Again, his number, 666. That's from the numeric value of 1661. Trump War Room. That comes up. The Four Horsemen of the Apocalypse. It's another sign that comes up. And here we have a few. I'm going to go through a few here with Donald John Trump. I have this printout. This is some time ago, but there's more. It's up on the link that I'll leave on the video that we're making. Okay, Donald Don Trump has this is the coordinate, the numeric value of 1110. These are signs. These are evidences. Okay, this is not made up. For Donald John Trump, World Trade Center, the word of Thoth, that's an occult group, Thoth, T-H-O-T-H, the word of Thoth, Jesus God incarnate, true Messiah of God, secret angel master, the Bethlehem Messiah, that comes up under the name Donald John Trump, anointed of the Lord. What Lord? Anointed of the Lord. Rod in his right hand. Stock market crash. That comes up. U.S. dollar collapse. That comes up under the name of Donald John Trump. Book of Revelation. King YahOshahvah decoded. Also, Yeshuah, the Messiah. Yeshuah is a Jewish term, meaning his name is cursed. So under Donald J. Trump, Donald John Trump, Yeshuah, the Messiah. Aleister Crowley, that name comes up when you do these calculations. This is evidence online right now. Most people know nothing about. This is another meaning that comes up under his name. Tree of knowledge. Good and evil? Tree of knowledge. You are the Illuminati. You are the Illuminati. Let heaven roar and fire fall. This also comes up under the name Donald John Trump. The Soul Destroyer. Host body of the dragon Satan. The Great War. Secrets kept hidden. Impending judgment. I'm not making this up. Do your own research. I'll leave you the link to do your own research. Bottomless pit comes up with the gematria. Bottomless pit. Book of Revelation. Secrets kept hidden. The secret ark door. Enemy of the people. Reptilians of good. That comes up. This is the last one I'll get, then we'll get on to something else. Listen to this. This is under the name Donald John Trump. I of the concealed one. Does that bring up any image in your mind? The pyramid of power. I of the concealed one. There, computer calculated the Hebrew and the English and the geometric calculation of the meaning through numerics of a full identity or name. Ecumenicalism, world peace, coordinated with this group of people. These are the people, the main ones, that are doing an ecumenical peace process and a one world religion for all God's children, ecumenical unity, the Jesuit Pope, Donald Trump, and Jared Kushner are the three main players. There are others. There's the Secretary of Foreign Affairs and so on. And there's people they coordinate with, a lot of different people. The three main individuals right now putting together this peace and security Abraham agreement between the three major religions. They all say they have their origin with Abraham, and they all can be in agreement. Forget about Jesus is the only way. Don't cause any waves. Just come into an agreement. We're going to have peace and security by way of the Pope, the Jesuit Pope, Donald Trump, who undoubtedly has ties to not only Jesuits, but to high Freemasons. And Jared, fully Jewish Jared Kushner, who is a Shabbat, devout Orthodox Jew, including Kabbalah. They study Kabbalah in the Talmud. Those three, you need to watch very carefully, and do not be deceived. Because he comes in peaceably with a small group of people. He's not, initially he's not considered to be, he keeps a low profile. All his life he's kept a low profile and made lots of money and married into the Trump family, and his wife, who was a Presbyterian, renounced Christ and became a Shabbat Jew. She's officially a Jew. She's no longer a Christian. She identifies as a Jew. Trump will identify both as a Jew and as a Presbyterian, ecumenical. Ken Copeland, Paula White, Christian, that will go along with peace and security. See? But I want you to know, this is the important point to remember, aside from investigating all this evidence I've already accumulated on my Facebook page. Look it up. The Jewish people are desperate for their Jewish side. They know they're on the brink of war. They know they could be annihilated. They know the world is one horrendous, they know it's in a horrendous moral pit. They know the world is in moral chaos and economic chaos. And there's at least four or five different places where there could be a World War III. The flashpoints are in at least four or five different places, including India, China, and Pakistan, and India, and North Korea, and the South China Sea, and the Ukraine, and Syria, and Iran, and Turkey. I mean, there's major flashpoints that all the Jews know this. All the politically aware people realize we're this close to a major war. If we can't find some way to avert it, well, we need a Jewish Messiah. We need to rebuild the temple. We need to have peace among all of God's children. There are no weed of tears. There's no conflict between the children of light and the children of darkness. So say the high Freemason and the Luciferian and the Jesuits and the Shabbat Jews that are looking for their Messiah. They're sure not looking for Jesus or Yeshua. They're not looking for him. You talk to any Orthodox Jew, ultra-Orthodox, Shabbat, any of them, and most other Jews for that matter. You talk to a Jewish man or woman, and they will tell you, Jesus, that's a Gentile religion. That's their Messiah. You can keep your Messiah. We're looking for our Jewish Messiah. In comes Jared Kushner, the mastermind. There's a video on my YouTube. There's a video on my link on my Facebook. It's the former ambassador to the United Nations for the U.S. and a very close advisor to President Trump, saying that Jared Kushner is an absolute genius. He's working behind the scenes more than anybody knows, and he doesn't take any credit. He works behind the scenes. And several times, in this video, you look at it yourself, most people have never seen it,
she's in an interview, she says he's a genius. He knows how to get things done. And this was 2017 or 2018. Donald Trump was at a rally. He was on stage and he was talking about, we need to have the deal of the century. We need to have a peace process that will last between Israel and all of her neighbors. And he looked at Kushner and said, if anyone can do it, you can. You're the man. Negotiate the peace process. Now, Trump, and I think his foreign secretary, or Trump and Netanyahu, are both up for the Nobel Peace Prize. But who's in the background, having made all the negotiations, done, coordinated all this? Jewish Shabbat, Corey Kushner. And I mean, he looks like, you talk about a power couple. You look at that couple, and you, with the three children, you think that they're a perfect example of a Jewish righteousness, of genius, of success. I mean, you want a success story. You look at Jared Kushner and what he's been through. Mm-hmm. So it's all right if you want to keep your Jesus, your Gentile Jesus Messiah. We want our Jewish Messiah. He'll bring peace. Mm-hmm. It's all happening now. And people are going to make a choice, just like they will with the vaccine and the biometric tag and the mark of the beast and the buying and selling. And how do you get your freedom to go out and do whatever you want, even go to a big sport coliseum? You better have your vaccination. Get that in your blood first. Then we have to put a tag, a biometric tag, certifying that you are enabled to go out your door. Otherwise, you stay at home. We won't necessarily twist your arm or bring the military there to require it. You want to go out and do anything. Just go outside. You want to have your freedom? Get your shot. Be vaccinated. It's why you should trust big government and big pharma. Trust the medical profession. They're always right. They wouldn't mess with your DNA. They wouldn't require you to have a certification to buy and sell, would they? Government? Do you trust in man? Do you trust in government? Do you trust in big pharma? Do you trust in the medical profession? Do you trust in man, or do you trust in God? I made up my mind. God says, mark of the beast system, the false Christ, the false prophet, it's all happening. Do your own research. Look into this for yourself. The book of Daniel and Revelation and Matthew 24 and Luke 21, all the prophecies are coming to a fulfillment, a convergence. Okay? And we need to be informed. We need to be aware. That's what this sharing during Shabbat is all about. And why I have a YouTube channel and why I'm trying to get the word out through Facebook or any way I can. I mean, those are the two main platforms. I don't use Reddit hardly at all, or others. But one of the ways we can reach the world is through the internet. Mm-hmm. Until we're taken out of here, or until they shut us down. I mean, it's a fact now, and it's a very disturbing fact. And it's a very disturbing fact that many Christian truthers on Google and YouTube and Facebook, they're being deleted or shut down or frozen, if not completely shut off and deleted. Why? Because they say something about a vaccine you shouldn't take, that maybe you shouldn't trust the big brother. They start talking about sin is sin,
your sin will find you out. If they talk about really holiness and repentance and expose the evil that has permeated this world, there's at least a few that are doing it. A few thousand, not millions and millions, but there are people that have been called as watchmen to warn and are saying, look at this sign, look at this, look what's happening in the world. Now, what are you going to do about it? Besides pray, and most people aren't even praying. The world is in a complete moral sewer, a pit of immorality and perversity, and all the signs of the coming of the beast and the Antichrist and the return of Christ is everywhere, and most people are not even praying about it. What does that tell you? Let alone crying out to God. But what we need, so I'll just tell you what the church needs, the real church needs more than anything else, is worship and prayer and intercession and crying out to God. Which we're going to do after this sharing. We have our prayer time and our worship time. We need to have more of that. The thing Satan hates most of all and tries to hinder, worship and prayer.
Yes.
They go together. Yes. Fervent work and extended worship and prayer. And he'll try to hinder that all he can. But it is, and I want you to know, that is the highest form of spiritual warfare. I mean, the demons run and scream.
Yeah.
Once you get into the presence of God and you start worshiping, and you pray, and you cry out to God, and you bring your offering of prayer before God, the demons flee. They can't stand that.
Yes.
They try to hinder it all they can, and try to get people to get fighting among each other or other stupid things, which is stupid and carnal. But I'm exhorting people. If you're a Christian, if you love the Lord, if you have any discernment, the signs of the times and the lateness of the hour, get together and have, especially on Shabbat, what the world calls Saturday or Saturday, what the Romans label Saturday. Shabbat Shalom, a time of seeking God, worship and prayer and intercession. Intercede for the remnant of Israel. Intercede for the remnant of the church, the ecclesia. Intercede for the remnant of every tribe and every nation. God has a remnant. It's called the few, not the many. God never called us to intercede for the tares, the goats, the Nephilim, the children of darkness. He didn't tell us to intercede for them. Or for the world. He said, intercede and pray for the lost sheep, for the remnant people. God works with a remnant. He knows the heart. He tests. He knows who the remnant is, who and what they're all about. He didn't call us to make America great again. Freemasonry, Jesuit America, warmongering America, mammon, prophet, worshiping America,
yes.
Luciferian-run America, Trump, Kushner, no, it's not about making America great again or safe or powerful.
Good.
It's not about the United Nations. It's not about the EU or the New World Order. That's all going to burn, including Mystery Babylon. Hear me. Including Mystery Babylon. read, if you've never bothered to read or study it, read about the Roman Empire religion and the Mystery Babylon commercial power, Revelation 17 and 18. Read Revelation 7, it's all there. It's all there in Daniel and Revelation. In Matthew 24, Luke 21, the prophecies of Paul, the prophecies of Isaiah and Jeremiah, Zechariah. If you did the study, it's obvious that it's happening now. Not 10 years from now, not 100 years from now, not 5 years from now. Now it's happening. That's how late the hour is. And I don't see any way it's going past this decade. This is, I don't mind declaring it, I don't care who said, no, it can't be so. This is the last decade of Adam's prophetic history. Then the second Adam takes over. It's called the millennial reign of Christ. This is the last decade that Satan will dominate the nations and the many and the millions and the billions. Billions! Because it comes down to a choice of who is your Lord.
Yes.
And your Savior in whom you trust by way of revelation. No man comes unto me unless the Father draws him by the Spirit. No one! The remnant that God has foreknown and that God tests, He refines. Like silver and gold, meaning refining. But to the many, to the tares, the goats, the Nephilim, the children of disobedience, the children of darkness, He is a consuming fire.
Yes, Lord.
You don't know God until you rightly fear Him.
Yes, Lord.
And revere Him. Why? Because He's the judge, and you can't pull anything over on God. He doesn't accept pretense, hypocrisy, flesh, false professions. Credentials mean nothing to Him.
Yes.
He is rightly to be feared and obeyed. Feared and obeyed. Ha-ava, the divine love. Ha-ava, YahOshahvah. Ha-ava, eternal divine love. Ha-ma, YahOshahvah. Abba, Abba, Father. Abba, YahOshahvah. YahOshahvah.
Amen.
HaKodesh. Holy. The Holy One. HaKodesh. The Holy One. The Holy One. HaYah. The Eternal. HaYah. The Eternal. The eternal love, one love, the eternal love, a flame of holy love, Elohai, Elohim, Elohim, the sovereign master, the ruler, El Elyon, the most high God, El Gibor, the almighty God, the Almighty One, El Gibor, and He remains eternal love. One. One, two, three. Three in one. One God. Three persons. The restoration of the beauty and the holiness of God's name and understanding His word, even His prophetic word, is wonderful. It's a gift. But it's a gift given to those who seek Him with all their heart. Okay? Why God chose me to understand and to seek after knowing and understanding His identity and His personal name, lost and mistransliterated and even obscured, masked, obscured for many centuries, and replaced with Lord, God, Hashem, other generic words, or even Jesus or Jehovah. Those are not the correct pronunciation or transliteration of His personal name. And there's others that God has used on restoring the name of Yahweh and Yahuwah. But I have revelation, and God is my judge. I mean, listen, through prayer, through revelation, through study. Leonard Charles Hummel, most everybody has three personal names. God is three persons. Yahuwah. Over Yahweh fits together perfectly. And the meaning of those three names together is awesome. No one, no other God, no other person could ever declare that as their name.
Amen.
See? So Amen. Aside from restoring the house church and the Shabbat sharing as a family and worship and prayer, it's important that God wants to restore the knowledge of His name.
Amen.
As I said, I'll say it again as we close this time of sharing. There's two things most holy in all of the universe, in all of creation. The first is His Word, which is His will. The Word and the will of God. And the second one is His holy name. What could be more holy than His name? What could be more holy than the Word and will of God? So those are the two things He wants most restored to His people. Because my people are destroyed, because we're ruined for lack of knowledge. Well, not only not lack of knowledge of His Word, what about a complete lack of knowledge and reverence or understanding of His name? Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Okay, look up the high priestly prayer of Jesus, John chapter 17. Yeshua clearly talks about how I've kept them through thy name. There's at least four major verses in John 17, very clearly right there in the New Testament, that talks about the importance of knowing His name. Who is the one? Who is responsible for obscuring and hiding the knowledge of the name of God? G-A-H-D, not with an F. Ah, that's why the Jews always have a dash between the G and the D. They leave out the sacred vowel, ah, of Yah. God. See, even the generic term has the sacred vowel. But all that's, I've gone into that before, very important. Seek it out for yourself. Say, Lord, I heard about Yahweh. I know about Jehovah. And I even heard about YahOshahvah. Okay, people have had some exposure to that name. Seek it out for yourself. Ask God for revelation. I want to know just as clearly and as accurately as I possibly can, what is the fullness and the revelation of your personal name? Even as everybody agrees, YHVH,
The W is not really, that's not ancient. It's the V, the Vav. Y-H-V-H, Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh. But the sacred vowels begin with A-H. Then the O, the sign of infinity and eternity. O and U and I and E. Okay, but the two main ones are the A and the O. You search it out for yourself. Search out the Hebrew, do the research, but most of all, pray for revelation. God wants His people to know His name. I guarantee you, He wants you to know and to reverence and invoke and call upon His name.
Amen.
Including Yeshua, the modern transliteration of Yahshua is Yeshua in Israel, in modern Hebrew. In the ancient Hebrew, it's not Joshua, it's Yahshua. Then read Numbers, look it up, Numbers 13, verse 16. God had Moses change the name of Yahshua. In the King James Version, it says YahOshahvah. It's Yah. Yahshua, YahOshahvah, with the O, the capital O. Okay. We're ready to pray. We're going to play the shofar one more time, and then we're going to have a prayer time. I want everyone to do their own research on two things. Please, record this. I'm asking, I'm urging you, I'm pleading with you. Listen to me. Do your own research on the personal holy name of God. And the evidence and the videos and the posts that I put up in the last 24 hours on my Facebook regarding the emergence of the final false Jewish Messiah, which is Antichrist, because they absolutely will reject Jesus, Yeshua, as their Messiah. It will be a man at the right hand of President Donald Trump, a mastermind of the peace process, a billionaire, and a very shrewd operator.
Thank you.
Without you, we're nothing, Lord. But with you, we are victorious.
Yes, Lord.
In your name, and by your Spirit, and the quickening of thy will. Every word we have ever read from your book, Genesis to Revelation, every word we have ever read from your book, Genesis to Revelation, every truth that we have ever read or heard or received, I'm asking you to quicken it in our mind and our heart to a word of truth. That we would live it. It's not enough to know it. It's not enough to preach it or teach it. We must live as the living word by your Spirit. Your word is only a legal religious system without the quickening of the living Spirit, the truth. Anoint the word in our mind and our heart that we would walk in victory and in your overcoming power is our prayer. In Jesus' name. We had a good time of prayer. I pray that there be even more hours we can have during the week, especially on Shabbat. Hours of praying and worship, more praying and worship. But lately I've had so much I've had to share that's on my heart. I've had to share these things. And I want to share a few notes here. I'll just read this and maybe a little bit of commentary with it. But I wrote this down, judgment that has been long delayed. God has been 2 prophetic years, 2,000 years he's withheld his wrath and judgment. Judgment, long delayed, is now being loosed upon a world of sin and a world as it was in the days of Noah and Lot. Long delayed, but not any longer. What do we see? Pestilence, plagues, stress and distress, and perplexity of nations and governments and people, not just the poor, not just the oppressed, the middle class, even the upper class, they're distressed. But the people that don't own property and they don't have lots of money, lots of stress and distress and perplexity of nations. It's happening now. I'm 73. My 70 years, I've never seen anyone. I've seen all kinds of people testify. In all my life, I've never seen the world in this kind of mess. Why? Reaping what the world has sown. That's what this judgment, long delayed, is all about. God said, okay, enough is enough. Now you're going to start reaping judgment. Reaping what you've sown. Economic crash at the very door, any day, any week, economic crash and food shortages leading to famine. How many heard about all the locusts? Billions of locusts in Asia and even going into parts of Europe and Eastern Europe. Food shortages and famine, that's a big one. Social breakdown of social police, authority, lawlessness, leading to martial law, and a new world order, cashless society, based on AI, artificial intelligence, digital ID, digital money, and required biometric tattoo or mark. That you're certified. You have the digital ID, you have the digital money, you are required to have the vaccination and the certification of a biometric tattoo. Also at the brink with 4 or 5 major hotspots in the world, World War III, which could even, on a limited degree, turn into a nuclear war. Mm-hmm. Nuclear war. Only God intervening will stop that. Jesus said that unless those days would be shortened, what did he say? No flesh would be saved. The whole world would be wiped out, in other words. That's what he meant. Unless God intervened and those days are shortened, no flesh would be saved. Does that sound like World War III to you? Just to me. So we have many areas of conflict and flashpoints that could lead to World War III. Even an EMP, electromagnetic pulse, nuclear. The compliance factor. Comply to the New World Order and you'll be just fine. We are at the brink of the fulfillment of Revelation 17 and 18. And the false Messiah, a man of peace, soon steps on the world scene, becomes very prominent. Very hailed as a great man of peace and a negotiator, the man that can wield power and can be trusted. Prophetic timetable. Okay? I'll go through this just as quickly as I can. A prophetic timetable from 2020 to mid-2024 and 2027. All this before 2030, before the end of this decade. Understand that Jesus finished his mission at Passover and at Pentecost in 30 AD. Some say 20 AD. Some scholars say it was probably 20 AD. Well, add to 20 AD 2,000 years. And this is what's happened at the end of the 2,000 years. We are approaching right now the very end of the last 2,000 years, or the two prophetic years since Jesus left the earth as the Lamb of God and finished his mission. The COVID pandemic that is using the fear factor for world control over the masses of people. COVID-ID, COVID-19. The New World Order comes out of chaos. Order out of chaos and conflict. That's how the Luciferians have always been. They know how to make that happen. The elite, or in other words, the 0.01% of humanity, Adam's race, the elite take down the old order of governments and nations and take it down and take over the elite. The elite are Luciferians, make no mistake about that. They are not fundamentalists, they're not biblical Christians. They are an elite, the Jesuits, the High Freemasons, they belong to occult groups, and most of them are multi-billionaires. The elite I refer to as the 0.01%. And what are they doing? They are culling the herd. Read the Georgia Guidestones. The Georgia Guidestones. Eliminate 7.2 billion of the herd because of overpopulation. And that's for the green ecology. That's to save the planet. Culling the herd. There's about at least 7 billion too many people. Georgia Guidestones. And now there's also, in relation to the pandemic, a worldwide lockdown requiring compliance, leading to martial law, and all under the control fear factor. Why, this flu will kill everybody. Less than 0.5%. The others in about 2 or 3 weeks. They But the whole world is in an uproar. The control fear factor. Now, please notice, in recent months, just within the last year, billions of locust swarms, crop failures, floods, food shortages, economic crash is coming big time. All this within the last year. New World Order digital ID driven ID, the ID 2020, they call it. Digital ID and digital money. They're talking about a required vaccine at warp speed and a biometric tattoo, but they won't call it a mark. It'll be your certification. It'll be biometric. It'll be easily scanned. A biometric tattoo. And all these things, including famine, will lead to more and more riots and major martial law required. But you better have your digital ID and your tattoo. You better have your biometric, but don't call it a smart mark. Your certification. Along with that, there's increasing severe weather. Jesus prophesied that. It's in the Bible. Many calamities, earthquakes, volcanic eruptions. I'm not making any of this up. Threat of World War III. And finally, the final Antichrist, false man of peace, in full disclosure. I mentioned this in my Facebook, that there's really the primary candidates for the final Antichrist, clearly, Kushner and Trump working together. Trump is the one preparing the way. Kushner is the one who is emerging. The other one they talk about, of course, they talk a lot about Obama. That's only if Obama ever comes into great political power again. He's out of power. He talks on the media, but he doesn't have it. They want to save the human race and the planet Earth. That's all been put out there in science fiction and Hollywood. So if it's not Jared Kushner, somehow that is not a human being as we know human Adam's race. It's a set of cards, so to speak. Could there be an alien invasion? At full disclosure, after the restrainer is gone, of course there is. It's very possible. That's the other clear possibility. I list all four. There's at top of the list is the Jewish Shabbat Orthodox Jewish negotiator, right hand man, President Trump. Okay. Look up the gematria, the geometric. Meetings of Jared Corey Kushner, and consider where his family business headquarters was in New York City. That's number one. Number two, a lot of people still think it's going to be Obama. Number three is the president of France. Number four, the fourth one, is really, sounds like the Twilight Zone. But believe me, Satan's got a big delusion. Satan is the ultimate schemer. You talk about a conspiracy, he's got all kinds of conspiracies and schemes. And it certainly could include aliens that manifest themselves as not as aliens or extraterrestrials. We are your brothers that have come to save you from World War III and famine. And all this confusion and all this misery, the human race is going to become extinct. So we are going to intervene and save you as the alien brotherhood. You think that couldn't happen? In the occult world, in the New Age world, they call him Sananda, Maitreya, the Maitreya Buddha, the Avatar, the Messiah, the Maitreya Christ. They said that that's the new name of Jesus, as they have, from all the New Age and all the occult people, they call him Sananda, the betrayer, the Christ. The world teacher, and he's an alien that only comes out during full disclosure after the church is gone.
Yes.
The bride.
Yes.
Because they restrain it. How? By our presence and by our prayers? God's not going to send full delusion and judgment until his bride is out.
Yes.
That's either pre or mid, one of the two.
Yes.
There's no other option. It's either pre or it's mid. Either or, one. I'm hoping for pre. Amen. But as far as I know, we could already be in the 7 year tribulation. I don't know. Even my wife said that quite a few times.
Yeah.
She said, how do we know? We could already be in the 7 year tribulation period. Yeah. It's entirely possible. Some say, oh, but they have to have the temple, or they have to have this, and they have to... No, there's tribulation all over the earth. Open your eyes.
Right.
Tribulation like the world's never seen. Chaos, unrest, anxiety. Many people are at the point of suicide. Despair. Mm-hmm. Not just anxiety. Many people are in despair. They see no hope. Mm-hmm. They don't have the blessed hope.
Yeah,
like you and I do.
Yeah.
If I didn't have the blessed hope, I'd be in despair too. Look around.
Amen. Well,
I have a blessed hope. I have a living hope.
Yeah, praise the Lord.
I have a living Savior. Yes. Most people, all they have is a little bit of religion or New Age, or just depend on their own ability to get through the day or have a future. Mm-hmm. Why, there's no future for this world. Except judgment. We got to close up with this. This is where we need to be, my friend. Resting, perfect stillness, holy shalom. Our shalom is in Him. Yeshua Sar Shalom. Listening, hearing, not just talking or praying, listening, hearing, and renewed and restored relationship in him, holy shalom, in him. Now, call upon his name in trusting, grateful love. Love, Ava, love, Yah, YahOshahvah, YahOshahvah. Ava. Ava love, calling on his name, which means eternal love. There's no other being, no other God, no other person could have that. That's his last name. That's the final word about the Father. Yah Ava. Yahuwah, Yehovah, YahOshahvah. Call upon his name. Hallowed be
thy name.
This is what we need to be doing. Stay focused on that. Thank you, Lord, for this time together. Thank you for everything you've done, everything you will do, all that you are. You are the I am that I am. I will be what I will be, and I will do what I will do. That also is the hidden meaning of your name. YHWH, Yahuwah, Yahuwah. You are the I am, the eternal I am. I will be what I will be, and I will do what I will do. No one can stay my hand, saith the Lord. You are the one that determined the time and the seasons, the when, and you determine the outcome because you know the why. W-H-Y. You know the motives. And you test the spirits and the souls. You know the motives and the why. You're the judge of all the earth. You're the judge of heaven. We praise you. We thank you. Help us, Lord. Help us to occupy until you return and reach souls for your kingdom.
Amen.
That's why we're here. That's the main reason you kept us here this long. Is to reach souls for your kingdom. The
lost yes, key, Lord.
By whatever means. By whatever means. And you can get it through us to reach lost souls. We praise you and we thank you for everything. Especially for this time that you have ordained and you have brought forth this time of prayer and worship. We praise you. We praise you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Yeshua. Hashem. YahOshahvah. The name. In the name of YahOshahvah. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.